Hi, this is Graham from Jedham's Astro. I've been using the StellaLyra 10-inch Dob for a few weeks now, and in this video I'll give you my first impressions of how the scope is shaping up. Okay, so there's a few topics I want to cover in this video now that I've used the scope for a few weeks. So the first thing we're going to look at is finding targets. So we're going to be focusing on this part of the scope here with a finder. Then we're going to look at focusing. So we're going to see whether this dual speed focuser is worth having. And then we're going to look at collimation. So we're going to be spinning round to the back of the scope behind the mirror cell. And then finally, going to give you my first impressions of the optical quality of the scope, showing you some examples of objects that I've looked at using this 10-inch Dob. So one of the things that attracted me to this particular scope was that it came with a right angle corrected image finder scope. So this 8x50 unit. And what I found, having used it for a little while, is that it is great in terms of if you've got an object in the field of view of the finder, then it's quite easy to translate that into finding the object in the eyepiece. However, the field of view of the finder itself is really just still too small. With Dobs, as with a lot of scopes, you find yourself lying on the floor looking along the length of the tube. So what I've done in order to get closer to the object initially before I use the 8x50 is to attach a tail rad. Okay, so having watched a few videos on people's opinions in the forums about how to set up a tail rad or similar red dot finder, I've chosen to mount the scope on the opposite side of the 8x50 to the focuser. So I already had a tail rad, but because I've used that on other scopes, what I've discovered really is that if you attach it directly onto the base, it's really quite difficult to get a clear view of the sky through the RDF without actually lying on the floor, which, let's be honest, we don't really want to do that. So to make it slightly less onerous, I've attached the tail rad using a riser plate. So I've chosen the 2-inch. There's also a 4-inch option available. It's just a piece of plastic. It seems to work quite well in terms of compromise between it not sticking out too far from the tube and usability. Okay, so finding objects is now easy. However, what I've found is that adding the weight of the tail rad upset the balance of the scope. So even though I've got this feature, which I talked about in the unboxing, where you can slide the tube inside its mountings relative to the pivot point, that's quite helpful because you can shift the mirror further away from the pivot point. But even so, the scope sags when you use it to look at objects that are close to the horizon. And it was really quite difficult to get a satisfactory combination of friction without clamping this too hard and controllability of the scope. So what I've ended up doing is putting some weight at this end of the tube. Now, there's lots of ways of doing this. In my case, I've just used, I think it's like a fitness weight belt that we had just lying around unused, and just allows me to put a bit of weight inside this and slide it up and down fairly easily. It's not marking the tube, and it's quite easy at night to find the balance position. So the combination of putting the tail rad on, certainly using heavy eyepieces like the standard 30mm, which I really like, by the way, it upset the scope a bit, and this seems like a compromise that's it's pretty easy and it's not really costing any money. So what about the focuser? Well, the two-speed dual speed unit, pretty handy really. The 1/10 is very useful when you want fine focus, focusing down on some stars or maybe on a planet. You've got a couple of adjustments here. You've got a locking screw and you've got a tension adjustment screw here. And in combination, I'd say it works pretty well. Not high end, but definitely serviceable as a standard focuser. I found that when I use a 2-inch eyepiece, standard 2-inch eyepiece instead of the 1.25, then the eyepiece needs to slightly stand off the fully inserted position in order to get to a good focus, which, yeah, it's not really ideal. I usually have it perhaps 5mm from being fully inserted, but still, it's a bit of a niggle. I don't use the extension tube that came with this scope. Other than that, someone sent me a question about focusing an astro camera. So I did a little experiment to see whether I could get one of my ASI cameras to focus. And summary, yeah, piece of cake. Going back to the 1.25 arrangement. Swapping out the eyepiece. Put a bit of wobble in now. Grabbing the camera. Okay, so if we put this, this is a 224. And in summary, what I did was I focused during the day to see, focusing at infinity, where the focus was. And essentially, it's when the focuser is around, it's around 1 centimeter out, as it were. So yeah, no problem with focusing a camera like this without any, no problems with getting it on extension tubes or not being able to reach the inward travel. So yeah, basically, we'll see that I've used this camera to give an impression of the optical quality, and we'll come to that shortly. Okay, so collimation. If we look around the back of the mirror cell, we've got a fairly sort of standard arrangement. We've got three locking screws here, the white ones, and we've got three sprung-loaded collimation screws. And it's the standard way of operating. I use a Cheshire eyepiece, but you might use a laser or some other means. But basically, you loosen off these white screws, and then you adjust the black screws in order to collimate the scope and then tighten everything down. So what I'd say is that's worked pretty well. It has held its collimation, certainly its rough collimation, quite well. No problems with the secondary after I made that initial alignment of that. When I bring it outside, I check the collimation each time, focus on Polaris, make any adjustments as necessary, and Bob's your uncle. So one thing that probably is worth noting is perhaps in an effort to, I'll pick this up, in an effort to make the knobs accessible around the back of the mirror cell, you can see that they do protrude. Now, the way it's set up is that the locking screws protrude further than the collimation screws. I think the idea behind that is that you could stand the scope on its end for storage and not be touching these screws. Now I'd say, well, not ideal, but it's always a trade-off between being able to reach these screws. You don't really ever have long enough arms to look through the eyepiece and adjust the mirror. But if you do stand it on its end, maybe in the packing material, then this arrangement seems to work, even though it seems that they're quite vulnerable, the screws sticking out the back. But I don't think there's a big issue there. Okay, so we've covered some of the mechanicals, looking at objects, focusing on them, collimating the scope. But I guess the most important thing of all, once you've done all that, is to see if the optical quality of this scope is any good, because otherwise really everything else is lost. So in order to assess that, I've spent a few nights looking at visual targets. So I've looked at some planetary nebulae, I've split a few double stars, and also had a look at Saturn and Jupiter that are visible quite low down at the moment in the southern sky. And what I've done is to try and give you an impression of their optical, of the optical quality of the scope. I've taken some video using the ASI camera, and then I've gone through my normal astrophotography process. Now, this isn't what I bought the scope for. I basically bought it to look through, and the idea is I don't bring any laptops or cables and all of that gubbins outside when I use the scope. It's really not about that. But just to give you a little bit of an impression of what you might see, I've captured some video and processed it into a couple of images in my normal sort of workflow of capturing video, stacking it, and then playing around in Registax. So having done that, I produced a couple of decent images of the planets. Obviously, big issue with this sort of scope is it's not tracked, so the target moves. And I found, as a very first go, I've set the camera into the eyepiece without using a Barlow, just to give myself a little bit more time to capture the planet before it goes out of the field of view. So I've done that and produced a couple of images. Hopefully it gives you an idea that the quality is very good. I've seen transits of the Galilean moons against the surface of Jupiter, and I've seen quite a bit of detail in the belts, looking visually in the equatorial belts. So yeah, first impressions optically, having used this scope on a few nights, is once I've got over the mechanicals of pointing and focusing and aligning, then I think it's going to be a winner. So StellaLyra 10-inch f5 dob, for me, yeah, good value, good first impressions. Always a few things to tweak with any new scope, I think. I mean, nothing is quite perfect when it turns up, but I'd say that this unit has quite a lot to offer. Portability wise though, going back to where this video started, just be aware, a 10-inch dob is a bit of a beast. I've ended up with a trolley, I've given up carrying it in two pieces, and the trolley works. It is a bit industrial, but I say definitely factor in how you're gonna move one of these things about. So, okay, I hope it's been useful. If you haven't subscribed yet to Jenham's Astro, please do so. I'll aim to make some more videos of this scope. Even though it's not an astrophotography scope, I'll aim to give you some more background on how it's working. So please press the button and subscribe, and thanks for watching.